Now that we can treat the quantum Fourier transform as a black box, things become significantly more simple again. We will see this directly in our first application, which is very general and is known as phase estimation. It is a genuine application in itself, but it is so general that it will also feature in all the remaining applications. And the idea of it is very simple, namely, what can we learn by inverting the quantum Fourier transform? So we start from these states here. Which earlier were the result of the quantum Fourier transform. And they were defined in this way here. And what I've done here is to isolate x divided by curly n in such a way that this is actually a number between 0 and 1. And now we want to run this through the inverse of the quantum Fourier transform, which we can just as well treat as a black box, because there we just need to apply all the gates in inverse order and use the inverse of the gates where this is necessary. And then the result would be our computational basis state x. What does this allow us? Well, it allows us to get direct access to these phase factors here. And in normal physical circumstances, this is something very difficult. If you think about how phase factors appear in interference, then they result in intensity patterns that you would have to measure very precisely many, many times to obtain a very good approximation of the different phases involved there. And when you measure the phase in this way, well, then you get statistical fluctuations, which are of the order of 1 over the square root of the number of measurements that you carry out. Here we have n quantum bits, and therefore we also do n measurements, but our outcome is an n-bit binary number, and therefore our precision will be of the order of 2 to the minus n, or 1 over curly n. So this is again exponentially better, well, in this case not to a classical measurement scheme, but to a measurement scheme in quantum mechanics that treats all the quantum bits independently, while in the quantum Fourier transform they all work together to give a much better approximation. So where do complex phases appear in the most general way in quantum mechanics? Well, they appear abundantly in the eigenvalues of unitary operators. So for any unitary operator u, if you look at the eigenvalues lambda, then they are always constrained to be of unit length, and you can then write them using a complex phase in this way here. I've written this here in a convenient form where I pulled out this factor of 2 pi so that phi can be treated as a number between 0 and 1, and this is known as the reduced phase. We can write it in this way because when we add integers to this, this doesn't change our eigenvalue lambda. This phase phi here, in the most general case, is a real number, but in phase estimation we aim to obtain an n-bit approximation for it, namely this approximation here. And this we can achieve when we can bring our quantum bits here into these kind of states, where x divided by curly n is simply replaced by phi. So in other words, we need to bring our quantum bits into these states here with the correct phase factor in front of the state 1. Well, this phase factor can actually be expressed in terms of the eigenvalues, because what we have here is 2 to the n times 2 pi I phi in the exponent, and this is just the same as lambda to the power 2 to the n. And these phase factors we get, on the other hand, by applying the unitary operator u 2 to the n times to the eigenstate u. So this already tells us what we really need. Namely, we need to apply this operator u conditionally so that this phase factor appears in front of the state 1. And this directly translates into the following quantum circuit. Namely, a circuit that is directly designed to produce the correct phase factors in the states of our quantum bits. But because we initially don't know what this should be, we start out by placing them all into these computational basis states 0. So up here we have n quantum bits, and this number n will determine the precision of our approximation of the phase. And then we need a mechanism to obtain this phase from the unitary operator u. So we certainly need to involve this unitary operator u, and this will indeed appear in n blocks. So we will have the operator u appearing in here, but not quite as I've written. There will be one more little modification, but let me first point out that we of course also need to have access to the corresponding eigenstate, little u, and so we assume that this is actually known. But in the later applications we will see how we can get around this assumption. And furthermore, our operator u is really arbitrary, so it can have arbitrary dimensions, and therefore we have an arbitrary number of quantum bits down here, which is independent of the number of bits involved in our n-bit approximation. We aim to bring these quantum bits into a state with a suitable phase factor in front of the basis state 1, and so we first have to bring them into a state where this basis state appears, which we can do with Hadamard gates. And so afterwards, each of these individual quantum bits is in this state here. And in order to obtain these phase vectors, we are going to apply these unitary operators, but conditionally, so that these phase vectors only appear in front of the basis state 1. But for the different quantum bits, we need to have these phase vectors with different powers. So while we here apply u just once, we apply it here twice. So this is really u squared. And on this quantum bit, we apply it 4 times. So this is u to the power 4. And to this one here at the very top, we indeed apply it 2 to the n times. And now it looks a little bit like we have to apply this unitary operator an exponentially large number of times, but there we can actually implement the same strategy that one exploits in the classical fast Fourier transform. Namely, we use the fact that when we apply this operator here twice, then we already obtain this operator here. So altogether, what we have then down here are really just of the order of n squared operations. And what we then have achieved is to place all these quantum bits individually into these states here with the factor of lambda to the power 2 to the n in front of the state 1. And therefore, what we really have obtained are states which look like the output of a quantum Fourier transform, these states z here. So then we just run these states through the inverse of the quantum Fourier transform. To obtain these states here. So these we then read out in a measurement, and this gives us our n-bit approximation of our reduced phase phi. So this is phase estimation, and it is indeed very general and powerful and gives us direct access to these phases phi by making use of the inverse of the quantum Fourier transform. And these unitary operators are so central and abundant in quantum mechanics because they represent, for instance, the time evolution operator and therefore also all our quantum gates. So this is very general, but we can then apply this also to some very specific unitary operators, and this indeed defines the theme of the remaining applications. And we turn to one of these applications straight away in this segment, and this is quantum counting. I mentioned this already when we introduced the Grover algorithm, and there I mentioned that there is a mechanism to obtain knowledge of this number curly m of matching entries in the database. Well, this number curly m is encoded in the angle theta because we had this relation here for the cosine of theta over 2 and the sine of theta over 2. And moreover, this angle theta appears in a certain unitary operator, namely the Grover iterate G. On the one hand, this is an operator in the complete Hilbert space of the quantum system, but on the other hand, this is also just a rotation in the two-dimensional space of capital X and capital Y, the two states signifying all the items that match or don't, and in there it is just an ordinary rotation matrix. And this matrix has the eigenvalues e to the plus or minus I theta. So by measuring this angle theta with sufficient precision, we can determine the value of curly M. Now we cannot assume that we know the corresponding eigenvectors because they actually depend on capital X and capital Y, but we know that the state capital Psi lies within this two-dimensional subspace. And therefore, this is a certain superposition of the two corresponding eigenstates, which I denote as u plus and u minus. When we start with the state u plus in our phase estimation algorithm, we end up with an n-bit approximation of our phase, given by this integer here. And when we start out with this value, then we essentially obtain this value here, where we basically read this all modulo curly n. And so therefore, when we start out in this superposition, we will end up in the superposition of these two states. And when we then make a measurement of all the quantum bits, we get only two possible outcomes. They are strongly correlated to either just give us this integer here or this integer here. And both situations simply occur with probabilities alpha squared and beta squared, assuming that we have normalized these states. And both of these outcomes are actually enough to obtain theta, and therefore curly M. So this is quantum counting, and this exploits this particular structure of the Grover iterate, where the angle theta encodes the number of matching items in the database. And so we can obtain knowledge of this number without finding any of these items at all.